so.
I know. I mean, I pre-registered websites. I have my receipt.
Okay.
I don't know if I.
Okay. So. We started talking about what hands you could be going all in with. And so these are some numbers to give you a sense of the chances certain hands have against certain other hands when you get it all in preflop. Okay, and these are good numbers to have a sense of. So, and you can get all these yourself by typing in PokerStove. So pocket aces against pocket kings, your chances of winning is about 82%. And you can type in PokerStove. Player one has pocket aces, player two has pocket kings, what's each person's equity? Okay, so in general, if you have a bigger pair against a smaller pair, you win about 80% of the time, okay? And also, similarly, if you have a pair against another hand with zero cards bigger than your pair, zero over cards, that's also 80-20. So pocket aces against ace king is actually 93%. So, I mean, it's not exact, but in general, it's about 80-20. And pocket aces against 6-5 suited is 77.5%. Pocket jacks against 10-9 suited is 81%, etc. So it's about 80-20. Okay. A pair against one over card. So if you have a pair of queens and they have one card higher than your pair, it's about 70%. So a pair of queens against ace jack offsuit is 71%. Against ace jack suited, you go down to 68%. Okay, so you don't have to memorize all these exact percentages, but you should know a pair, bigger pair against small pair is 80-20. Pair against zero over cards is 80-20. A pair against one over card is 70-30, and a dominating hand is 70-30. By dominating, I mean one of your cards is shared, and the other card is not shared. Okay, so ace-king against ace-queen is your dominating, because you both have an ace, and you have a king, and they have a queen. Okay, so it sort of makes sense that in this case, it sort of makes sense that both are about 70-30. Because in both cases, if you count how many ways there are for you to lose, there's three. Right? If you have pocket queens against ace-jack, for them to beat you, they can hit a straight, they can hit a flush, but for the most part, ace-jack is going to beat your pair of queens by hitting an ace. And how many aces are there? There's three left in the deck, right? And if you compare this to having ace-king against ace-queen, it's the same thing. How is ace-queen going to beat your ace-king? They're going to beat you by hitting a queen. And how many queens are there left in the deck? There's three. So it makes sense that both of these are approximately 70-30. And notice that once you get to ace 5 versus ace 2, it actually becomes close to 50%, because usually higher cards are going to come on the board that makes your 5 irrelevant. The 5 is only better than the 2 if both the 2 and a 5 comes, then you have a pair of 5s beating a pair of 2s. Okay, so the cool thing is 2 over cards against a pair is actually very close to 50-50. So ace-king suited against pocket twos is 49.9%. It's actually a very close to a coin flip. So two overcards against a smaller pair is very close to a coin flip. And so that's the other one to remember. Okay, and the last one to remember is when you have two different cards and they have two different cards and the cards are different, it's about 60-40. Okay, the person with the biggest card of the four is about 60-40 to win. So I'm assuming A, B, C, D are four different ranks where A is the biggest and D is the smallest. Like, so A, B versus C, D. So an example of this would be ace king against 7-6, you're about 61%. Ace king against queen 7, you're up to 68%. And ace A, C against B, D. Now this is slightly worse for the person with the A, with the biggest card, because if you pair your... So ace queen against king 9, if you pair your queen but they pair their king, you actually lose. So it's a bit worse, but it's still about 60-40. And in this case of ace 2 against 10-9, I guess that's the worst case, that's about 52. But for the most part, if you just remember 60-40 for this case, that's about good. So this is very important to learn, and it shouldn't be hard. You should just know when it's an 80-20 about, when it's a 70-30, when it's a 60-40, and when it's a 50-50. Okay? Okay, and I think I'm going to skip this slide. Okay, so now that we know the chances that certain hands against other hands when it's all in preflop, what hands do we choose to go all in with? So I said you start going all in if you have 15 big blinds or less. And if you have as high as 15 big blinds, I'm going to recommend that the hands you go all in with is exactly the hands that I said you could open with if no one, if everyone folds to you. Okay, so back a while ago, let's say under the gun, I said, these are the set of hands you could raise to 2.25 big blinds if you wanted to raise. If you have 15 big blinds, then this is going to be the same set of hands that you can, for the most part, profitably go all in with. But if the number of big blinds you have goes down, the percentage can increase drastically. And this sort of makes sense, right? Because as the number of big blinds you have goes down, you can risk more to try to win the blinds, right? If you go all in for 15 big blinds, and then you're essentially risking 15 big blinds, and how much do you win? If everyone else folds when you go all in, you win the big blind, the small blind, and the antes, which is about 2.5 big blinds, because the sum of the antes is usually about 1 big blind. So you're risking 15 to win 2.5, which is a lot riskier. But if you only have 5 big blinds, you're only risking 5 to win 2.5. So your risk-reward ratio is a lot better, so you can go all in with a higher percentage. Now, empirically, I'm going to tell you some percentages, and I'm going to try to give you enough data points such that you can, if you just look at these and think about it a bit, you can maybe try to interpolate for the other positions, right? So this was under the gun all in. If you have 15 big blinds, it's the 6.2%, which is the range of hands I told you earlier. Pocket eights are better, ace jack suited, king queen suited. And if you have 10 big blinds, about 13.4%. If you have 5 big blinds, about 33.3%. So I gave you approximate numbers that are approximately agreed upon amongst professionals that this is about the optimal to go all in with. Of course, it depends on your opponents, it depends on a ton of things, but for the most part, this is a decent rule of thumb, and so this is something you can look at to make sure you're not way off, okay? And here's another example, here's another data point for you, basically, for you to look at, too. So from the hijack, if you have 15 big blinds, the range of hands you go on with, which is the range of hands that you open with, is about 23.4. And with 10, I'd go up to about 28. And with 5, I'd go up to about 50. So if you notice, the curve increases slowly at first and increases faster later, right? The difference between 15 and 10 is way less than the difference between 10 and 5, usually. So for 15 big blinds, go on with the same range of hands I suggested earlier. And as the number goes down, you got to increase your percentage. Okay, I'm going to skip this. Okay, so here's sort of a summary of beginner preflop mistakes and what we learned today. So in general, you should be going all in when you don't have a lot of big blinds, and you shouldn't be playing that many hands in general. So I said from under the gun, you're only playing 6.2% of hands. All these hands that look all pretty, like Jack 10 suited, for the most part, I'm going to recommend that you don't play for now, because in the end, they're just not going to be the best hand out of 9 hands. So in general, the mentality you should think about preflop is bad players leak a small amount of money on a large number of hands. In general, the bad players will play way too many hands and put in a bit of money on each of them and not end up winning the pot. Whereas a good player will select a small percent of hands to play. And when they do get one of those good premium hands that they want to play, they're willing to go all in, willing to risk all their money on the one hand that they think is good. So this is the general mentality you should be playing with. And it's in general the general mentality that a lot of beginning players usually don't have. But this is the thing. This is something to keep in mind if you're going to play tonight or tomorrow night before we do more classes. So just some graphical pictures of what not to do. So here, this is a bad play by Under the Gun Plus One, because they're sort of making two mistakes. One is everyone's folded to them and they're not raising. They're not giving themselves a chance to steal the blinds. And two is they only have 10 big blinds, right? The big blind is 800. They only have 7,900. They should just be going all in. They should either be going all in or folding. So this is bad. Similarly, this is bad. They're only raising to 2 big blinds. They should just be going all in for all 10 big blinds instead of raising to 2 big blinds. Because by raising to 2 big blinds, they just allow other people behind better odds to call. So this is a good play. If you have a good hand, just go all in for 10 big blinds. And this is also a good play. Just fold and move on to the next hand. Okay, so let's talk a bit about why this is so bad. Okay, why is it so much worse to raise to 1600 than to go all in? And why is it okay to only raise to 1600 if you have more chips? Okay, so the difference between this picture is in this picture, everybody only has 8,000 chips. Everybody only has 10 big blinds. In the next picture, everybody has about 15,000 big blinds. So why is raising to 1600 okay when you have more chips, but bad when you have such a small number of chips? So let's suppose in the first case you raise to 1600 and someone behind you goes all in, okay? And you have ace 10 suited, which is one of the worst hands you should be raising from this position. So if you do a calculation, we need to put in 8 more big blinds. And when we put in 8 more big blinds, how big would the pot be? It'll be 10 big blinds from us, plus 10 big blinds from them, plus the small blind, plus the big blind, that's this 1 and the 0.5, plus 1 from the antes. So 8 divided by 22.5 is 36%. So you only need 36% equity. And if you estimate a reasonable range for them, say pocket sixes are better, ace jack are better, king queen, and you poker stove it, you have 39%. So basically you're going to call. And the lesson is, you put in a large enough portion of your stack such that even though your hand isn't that good, you basically have the odds to call in this situation. Okay, so what's the point? The point is, when you only have 10 big blinds, there's no reason to raise small, because the reason to raise small is to be able to escape when you have a bad hand. But when you only have 10 big blinds, or in this case 15 or fewer big blinds, usually you can't escape anyway. You have good enough odds to call in on anyway. So you might as well raise as big as possible and deny the big blind or any other players the opportunity to call profitably, right? So at the very beginning when I said how big should you raise to, I said raising small has the advantage of you being able to escape and lose a small amount when someone re-raises, whereas raising big has the advantage that you deny your opponent a profitable opportunity to call. But in this case, you can't even escape. You can't even escape by raising small. So all the advantage of raising to a small size is essentially lost. So that's why it's a really big mistake and you should just go all in when you don't have that many big blinds. When you have more big blinds, then you can escape when someone re-raises. That's why it makes sense to raise to a small size. Oops. Okay. So in the second case, right, in the second case, exact same scenario, except now you have about 19 big blinds instead of 10 big blinds. You do the same equity calculation, you'll see that you need 42% equity, and you definitely don't have enough, and you should fold. So in this case, you definitely profited by only raising to 1600 instead of going all in or raising to a bigger size, right? If you raised to 2400, you would have just lost 800 more chips to this. Or if you went all in, you would have had to go all in with the worst hand. So that's basically why. So these are the principles that you should always remember. So the advantage of raising to a small size is there's less risk when you intend to fold when they re-raise. And the advantage of re-raising to a large size is you deny them the odds to call profitably. Okay? And if you re-raise, if you re-raise how big to make it, if you re-raise to a size that would commit a critical portion of your stack such that you can't escape anyway, then you might as well just go all in. So here's an example. So you have ace king offsuit, which is a very good hand, and under the gun plus one raises to 2,000. And everybody has 40,000 chips, right? Let's say when you re-raise, you make it just 3,200 because you want to risk the least amount possible. Let's say you intend to fold if he re-raises you because you think he's definitely going to have pocket aces or something. So you're going to tell yourself, okay, I'll raise to a very small size, just 3,200, so that I lose the minimum when someone re-raises. But then if you look at the odds you're giving him, he needs to call 1,200, which is 1.5 big blinds, to win a pot of already 9 big blinds after he calls. a pot of actually 10 and a half big blinds when he calls. So he actually has 6-to-1 odds. So he only needs 1/7 equity to call here profitably. So in general, this is a very big mistake because you're giving him such good odds. And so it makes a lot more sense to make it something like 5,000, because now if you calculate it, you're only giving him 3-to-1 odds. Okay, so the same principle for figuring out how big to raise preflop apply to figuring out how big to re-raise preflop. It's the same principle all the time when choosing how big to make your bet, basically. Okay, and the only thing that changes is this critical portion of your stack sort of changes. And it gets smaller and smaller. It gets smaller and smaller as the hand goes on. So when I told you when you go all in, and if you have 15 big blinds or less, you should just go all in, because committing 2 big blinds of your 15 big blinds is already a critical portion. But if you're re-raising preflop, I'd say you need to commit 25% before it's critical. And the reason is because their hand range is going to be a lot stronger when they re-raise you. So even if you put in like 20% of your hand, of your stack, if you're so sure that they're going to have aces, you can still like get away. So the changes in the critical portion changes, but the same principles still apply. And post-flop, the same principles basically apply too. If you're figuring out how big to bet post-flop, once again, you don't want to bet so small that they can profitably continue whenever, but if you bet too large, then you're risking a lot. And in general, as you get closer and closer to the river, the equity of bad hands goes down and the equity of good hands goes up, right? So pre-flop, sort of any two cards has a chance because 5 cards are still gonna come. But if you don't have a pair by the turn, your hand, you could be drawing dead. You could have 0% equity. So in general, the sizing, you can make it smaller and smaller as the hand goes up. So preflop, you should never give your opponent like 9-to-1 odds, because chances are no matter what cards they have the odds to call. But post-flop, if you have 4 of a kind already, you know, giving someone 9-to-1 odds is totally fine, because they're not going to win 1 in 10 times. So I'll talk more about this later, but these are some bag things to keep in mind. Okay, and so one other tip for post-flop play, I would say, is remember the purpose of a bet. It's either to get your opponent to call with the worst hand, or get your opponent to fold a better hand. If your bet isn't going to accomplish one of these two purposes, then there's no point of betting, right? So a common situation is you think you have the best hand, but you think they're only going to call you with a better hand. Then what's the point of betting? You're only adding more money to the pot when that money you're going to lose. So even if you think you probably have the best hand, that doesn't mean you should bet. So often, you want to bet your really bad hands to get your opponent to fold their better hand, and bet your really good hands to get your opponent to call with the worst hand. And you don't want to bet your hands in the middle. And we'll see this poker principle sort of come into play later. Okay, I'm going to skip a bunch of slides and get to the end. So I want to do some things a bit fun for the very end. So we're going to look at a situation where we're going to call all ins. Okay, so basically hijack goes all in, and we do a calculation, and we realize that Sam 7717 should be calling the all in from the button with ace 8 suited. And basically the big blind calls with king queen suited in the big blind. Okay. So I think one of the most exciting things about poker, and one of the things that makes it a really fun thing to watch, is having people go all in preflop and seeing how the cards come out. Okay, so we're gonna have some fun. So now I'm gonna ask some cool facts, and these are gonna be the volunteers. Okay, so I'm gonna give I'm gonna ask some facts, and I'm gonna give $20 to whoever answers each of the facts, okay? So here's a question. Which hand other than aces has the most equity against aces? So does anyone know this or have a guess?
It's like 7-8 suited or 8-9
suited. Okay, close enough. Okay, so come down. Okay, come down here. But stay down here, okay? So the answer is 6-5 suited. The answer is 6-5 suited. of a suit different than both aces and has, so hold on to this, but stay down here, okay? And they have 23% equity, okay? And that's the best you can do against aces. Okay, good. Okay, second question. What's the most equity you could get, if you could possibly have getting it all in preflop? So you get to choose what two cards you have and what two cards your opponent has. What's the most equity? What's the best possible situation for you? So we saw some pretty good ones. Yeah.
Ace, king suited, and then queen jack in the same suit.
So you have ace, king, and they have queen jack? Okay, so that's not quite, because that's only a 60-40. That's only about a 60-40, because you have all different cards. So, okay, so someone else, yeah.
Is it ace, ace, may have king, king?
So that's an 80-20, but you can do a bit better than that. You in the red.
Aces versus, say, 7-2 offsuit.
Okay, that's very good, but you can do even a bit better. Because 7-2 offsuit can hit two pair. They have two live cards against your aces. Some of them over here.
Ace, ace, and then ace, king, non-suited?
Okay, that's close enough. Okay, good. That's close enough, yeah. Ace, ace against ace, king, non-suited, because they can't hit an ace. Okay, so come up. Okay.
If they're the seven, then they can't make a straight.
Right. So the actual answer is king, king against king, two, non-suited. Because aces can still tie, and aces can hit more straights than kings. So the answer is actually king, king against king, deuce, where your king dominates their deuce. Okay. Okay, the last question. The last question is, create a situation where you lose with 100% certainty no matter what cards your opponent has. Does anyone know how to do this? So in Hold'em, you want to create a situation where it's impossible for you to win no matter what your opponent beats you. So this one's a bit tricky.
You just have a worse hand than the board.
Right, but they can also have a worse hand than the board. So you want a situation that they cannot have a worse hand than the five cards on the board, but you have a worse hand than the five cards on the board. Okay, does someone have an idea of how to do it? Sorry. Okay, so good. So you have two and a seven with no suit. But what's the table? I mean, on the river. So you can tell me all five cards. You can tell me all five cards, and you tell me your hand.
I guess you have some cards so that the rest anything will beat you. So you have very low cards, and the rest of the low cards need to be.
Okay, that's a very good hint. Okay, I'll tell you the five cards on the table. Okay, five cards on the table are, let's say, queen, 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 two. Okay, these are the five cards on the table. What two cards can you have to make it so that no matter what your opponent will beat you? Who hasn't answered yet? You haven't answered yet.
Three.
Pocket twos. Pocket twos, good. Because if you have pocket twos, your opponent cannot have pocket twos. They must have a three to go. Okay, so come down. Yeah, that's good. Right, so the answer is 2-2 on XXXX2, where all the X's are the same. Okay, good. Okay, so you guys don't get to keep your money, though, yet. Okay, so what we're going to do is, I said we got in this all in, and each of you are going to choose one of the hands, and the winner is going to get all of the money. Okay, so I'll let you pick first, since you got the first one. Okay, so what's your name?
Justin.
Okay, so Justin, and you're a...
I'm a senior.
You're a senior. Okay, so Justin is an undergrad senior. Justin picks ace 8 suited. Okay, so I'm going to ask... So maybe all the undergrads can cheer for Justin as the cards roll. Okay, so you want to cheer for clubs and aces and eights. Okay, good. So what's your name?
Kara.
Okay, and you're
2013 Amber.
Ian.
Okay, so Kara, okay, which hand do you want to choose from the remaining two hands?
I think I'll do
Sam. Okay, he already chose Sam.
Then I will do cutie up there.
So Kara will choose king, queen of hearts. So maybe if you're in, Sloan, any kind of Sloan program, you can cheer for Kara. Okay, what's your name?
Ari.
Okay, so I guess you get the pocket nines. What program are you in? Nike undergrad.
Okay. Let's say everyone else. Okay. So. Okay. So you're also an undergrad. Okay. So. Okay. So everyone cheer. So everyone cheer for whoever you want. Cheer for whoever you want. So the cards are gonna come out. The cards are gonna come out, and the winner's gonna get all the money. Okay. So. Okay. So. Okay. So let's see. So. Okay. So first of all, what is the equity? Let's see if you people chose correctly. So the equities are actually preflop. It's 36.8% for king, queen of hearts, 26.8% for ace, eight of clubs, and 36.5% for pocket nines. Okay, but the result is predetermined. Okay, so this is the flop. So I made it as exciting as possible. Okay, so which hand would you take now? So now let's look at the equities, equity update. So now, ace eight of clubs is ahead, 35.1%, because they have the flush draw. Yeah. And pocket nines is the hand that's currently ahead, so they have 34.8%. And king queen of hearts isn't doing very well, but they do have the straight draw. And they do have some overcards as well, like if it comes a king or a queen, they're doing well. Okay, and I made the turn the most exciting turn card possible. So king queen picks up a heart draw, ace 8 picks up a pair of 8s, and pocket 9s picks up a straight draw, okay? So now queens no longer allow king, queen to win. But, okay, so now on the turn, we can calculate exactly how many cards for each player wins. So pocket 9s is ahead here. So out of the remaining cards in the deck, 18 of them result in a win for pocket 9s, 14 of them result in a win for king, queen of hearts, and 10 of them result in a win for ace 8 of clubs. Okay, so... Now, okay, so cheer for whichever hand you want. So usually these are some common poker terminology. So hold, brick, low. If you're cheering for pocket nines, you would probably say hold or brick or low. They basically mean low card. You want a small card to come. You want a card that doesn't affect the board to come because pocket nines is currently ahead. Okay? If you're cheering for ace eight of clubs, I don't know, you can say like clubs always, that's like a saying in poker. Clubs always get there. People always think clubs always make the flush. Okay, and the thing to say for hearts is usually, my heart is feeling strong. That's usually the saying that's it. Okay, so everybody cheer for like 10 seconds. Okay, so which hand do you want to win? Which hand? Okay, all right. Okay.
Loka.
Okay. So my online name is CutiePie314. So I made it a long time ago, and I wanted to make a math joke, and I was trying to be a girl. So that's my name. But all right. So sorry, guys. You almost got the money, but this is how poker works.
Yay! Look.